But in 1936, it was this district of Oranienburg that the Nazis, or to be more specific, the SS, chose to create not the first concentration camp, not the largest, okay, but it was the closest main camp to the capital of the Third Reich, which was Berlin. Okay, so 1936 is when Sachsenhausen was built. All right, I'll get a little bit more site specific in just a moment, but maybe we should go back and find out who the Nazis were. I'm pretty sure most of you have got some kind of idea. They weren't very nice guys. But let's go back. First World War, okay, ends. The end of 1918. Germany, who has been known as the German Empire, okay, actually loses their emperor. Okay, he's forced to abdicate, and Germany becomes a full-blown democracy. You might hear this period of time referred to as the Weimar Republic. Okay, and it's in this period, this democratic period of Germany's history, where we see the Nazis forming in Munich. All right, they're only a small, pretty fringe party to begin with. They basically stand for, they view history as a racial struggle. They are rapidly anti-communist, rapidly anti this liberal democracy that's come to Germany. As I said, an extreme party, which means no one's really that interested in the Nazis for most of the 1920s. It's only after the stock market crash of 1929 that we start seeing some popular support for these guys. Okay, we start seeing poor economic conditions, and we start seeing people throwing their weight behind the Nazis. On the 30th of January 1933, the leader of the National Socialist German Workers' Party, which is the full title, becomes Chancellor of Germany. All right. Which is a scary thing, but it's not the end completely. That's why, and apologies for those of you who were on my tour yesterday, just to repeat myself a bit, but what's so suspicious about, after Hitler becomes Chancellor, the Parliament House, have you guys seen the Parliament House, the Reichstag building with a big glass dome right near the Brandenburg Gate? That thing is set on fire. All right, and that thing is set on fire, and the big question for the ages really is, who set the Reichstag? Summer of 1936. Okay, what is happening in Berlin in the summer of 1936? Does anyone know?
The Olympics.
The Olympics, boom. Yes. Hitler's Berlin is on show for the world in a big way, all right, in the summer of 1936. But out here in the sort of sticks, let's say, it's business as usual. From some smaller camps, you have concentration camp inmates brought to this area. Okay, the trees are felled. The area is scoped out for what will be the first, once again, architecturally designed concentration camp. So we're standing here. Right, that's the T building that we just looked at. These are some of the houses from the SS housing estate. This here is the training ground behind some of you. All right, but this is the main prisoner compound. This triangle that we'll be entering into momentarily. You know, this doesn't happen by accident. All right, so they got an architect in, and here we'll maybe talk a little bit more when we get up close to it. Okay. So yes, that's 1936. You know, this was meant to be an expandable camp, as a camp of the future. You know, like Himmler, old mate here, he expects there's no, you know, we need these new camps to know no bounds as to how many people will be able to fit into them. So that was the idea, it's expandable. Its houses around 80 hectares, ends up around 380. It's around 384 sports fields. It's massive. And by the end, close to 100 sub-camps and external work details attached to it. All right, so this is the nucleus. You've got all these other sort of sub-camps scattered all around northeastern Germany. All right, so it's a mammoth. In terms of how many people came through here, again, we always have to be quite careful with numbers. We never really know exactly, but somewhere around the 200,000 mark from summer of 1936 until this camp's liberation in the April of 1945. Okay, actually the 22nd of April 1945. This is right at the very end. The Second World War in Europe ends on the 8th of May 1945. So it's really only a couple of weeks before. And it's not liberated by the Western Allies, but by the Soviet Union. Okay, they come here, and in that time frame, there'd been 200,000 people through here, and at least 35,000 people lost their lives in that time. Some died of starvation and disease, many were murdered, some in mass murder operations. But it's important to note, this was not set up as an extermination camp, so mass murder didn't take place. Here, we'll sort of talk about the the differences as we get a little bit further into it.
Somewhere that many inmates would this was kind of maybe a brief walk through here. Their area was on the other side of town, okay, which we'll be doing in a moment. Okay. It does look quite sort of picturesque here a little bit, the trees. There's more trees than there were. There were no memorials, obviously, back in the day. But even in front of the commandant's house here, there was a pond, swans floating around. There was a flower beds and a rose garden in here as well. This is to make the life of those working and living here that little bit sweet, but it was in stark contrast to what these guys are experiencing. So like I said, they come through Lagerstrasse like we have, they're on Tower A, they might not know. And remember, this isn't a prison system. That whole, remember I was talking about them right from the very beginning, right to the very end, when they are detaining people after the Reichstag fire. They've got a special name for it. It's called custody, which sounds really nice. The idea is that if you're a communist or whatever, for whatever reason, you're detained, we can't protect you in regular society. Who knows what us good Germans are capable of doing, so we need to put you somewhere for your own protection. And that happens to be a concentration camp. What that was just a euphemistic way of not going through any legal process. Long story short, when you're being brought in here as a protective custody inmate, as most people were, you're not being sentenced to a certain amount of time. You're just in here. You're not sure if or when you're going to be let out. Okay? So, with that in mind, what is it like? What's the experience of the inmates being brought here for the first time? It's pretty rough, as you can imagine. Okay? You can be whacked around, rifle butts, things of that nature, pushed over, beaten. Okay, certainly verbally abused. Okay, dehumanized. The idea you're being brought here, your name is turned into a number. Okay, your hair is shaved off, your civilian clothes are turned into a uniform, and that number that you've been given is sewn onto your uniform. Now, in Auschwitz, you may have read or heard about, in Auschwitz you had tattoos being done. This was not done here, this was done only in Auschwitz. Here you had your garments sewed onto your legs, to your trouser leg and to your shirt as well, your jersey. From 1938 onwards, you were also given a triangle. Okay, if you guys would like to see this closer, all of these images are your resources. So as we're walking along, say, hey Mike, can I have a look at the triangle thing? But for now, you should just be able to see a sort of variety of coloured triangles. And these coloured triangles were determined by why you were here. Okay, this was a quick reference point for the SS. They knew why you were here. And based on that, they sort of knew how to treat you as well. There was an unspoken, unwritten hierarchy, exactly. And the Reds and the Greens, the political prisoners and the criminals, were at the top of that pile, depending. Remember, there's always grey areas here. There's grey areas in life, right? History is just life. That happened some time ago. The green triangle for criminals could really depend what sort of criminal act you'd committed. Okay, if you had committed something that was if you were a child molester, for example, if you were a repeat sexual offender, something that was really frowned upon, you might be treated very, very poorly. The reason why some of the criminal class got some benefit was because some of them were violent. And remember, in these places, there's a variety of the population is always growing and contracting and so forth, but sometimes you have thousands, tens of thousands of people in here and only thousands of guards to look after them. So it's useful for the SS to find prisoners they can kind of get on side. Now, not everyone that's committed a criminal act is a bad person. I don't want you to take that away from today. But some of these guys were bad people. They committed violent criminal acts. Their morals were already, okay, they were already far gone. So, if you get the offer from an SS man to keep your barrack in line by violence, intimidation, torture, whatever it takes, for a few cigarettes, bit of extra food, your own bit of personal space in the barracks, in a world where virtually no personal space exists, that leap from victim to perpetrator is not so great for some of these criminal guys, but it's never a clear-cut thing. Some of them could be benevolent as well. So these are the top two, so the red and the green, political prisoners and the criminal class. The blue triangles were for a few different reasons, for foreign forced labourers, so people from the countries the Nazis occupied, I sort of just left them over here as labor. So if you were a Polish horse labor, you might have a blue triangle with the letter P for Poland. If you're from France, you might have the letter F for France, for Frankreich, so forth and so on. The purple triangle was for Jehovah's Witnesses. Now, are you aware of Jehovah's Witness? It's a religious denomination thought to be non-violent objectors, conscientious objectors. And in a society that's obsessed with expansionism and, you know, militarism, if you aren't going to fight or work in the war industry toward the war effort in any way, you're not liked and you're not respected, okay? But you are trusted in some regards. What did I say this green building was here? Mess hall. Where are the SS officers having their meals, having their drinks, things of that nature? Who do you think you might get to serve the food? If you're committed to non-violence, potentially you're not going to poison that stuff. I don't know, we'll get crazy with a steak knife, I don't know. So these guys, yeah, they're sort of in the middle. As we're getting down towards the bottom, you have the black triangle. Black triangle was for social outsiders. Not so many people know about this group of people. It was such a wide net. It was people, they here have written here Arbeitsscheu, which is work shy. So people, yeah, I mean, it was people that didn't have jobs, but also people that didn't have homes, people that didn't, you know, that had alcohol problems, perhaps, people that had disabilities, right? So these were social outsiders, really, is probably the best way to categorize the black triangle. Below that, I know it just keeps going, guys. Below that, the pink triangle was for homosexual men. Now, women were also targeted, absolutely, but not to the same extent as men, nowhere near the same extent as men. And they were often given the black triangle. This is the neutral zone. If you're caught here, you'll be shot without warning. That is what this is. Get a photo if you'd like, but let's maybe move slightly to sunnier.
Yeah, this right here.
Bam! So the barbed wire fence was electrified.
Oh my god.
This is actually a recreation, to let you know. This was torn down.
Electrified.
It would have gone around the main perimeter of this camp, but now this is just a sample. You sort of had that psychological pressure that we talked about to keep your mates in line. You had physical security, like the barbed wire fence, the death strip, and also SS men patrolling behind the barbed wire fence. And we were talking about this before, I think, another way of reminding people, you know, that the consequences of playing up, trying to escape or anything like that, was performing punishments, sometimes executions, publicly. Sort of a lifelike recreation of the hanging poles that we mentioned before. We will make a move now, I suppose. Okay? 5 minutes.
This is the inmate's clothes. There is a bed. There is a table. Can you see? There is a thing. The what? Oh, I guess you gotta jump over someone. Here are some original bricks from the original foundation.
Lydia, come here.
There are the clothes for the inmates.
Come here, wait.
Oh, yeah, I don't know what the word is. This is a map of the place. This stuff is exclusive stuff in the place. Over here.
Which means sort of like replacement coffee. It wasn't actually coffee. brown, warm, wet, and that was about it. Okay? And it's tasted so bad that what you would do if you got your bowl of coffee is rather than drink it, you might actually soak your feet in it just in the colder months just to get like a little bit of warmth, tiny little bit of luxury. Evening, your afternoon, your evening meal were pretty insipid as well. It was just watery vegetable stew, sometimes more water than a vegetable. All right, and yeah, so if you could supplement that by sneaking a few in here, so only those towards the top of the hierarchy would be getting jobs in the kitchen. And it was helpful to be chummy, to be friendly with these guys who were dishing out the food to you. Because if you're chummy with the guys dishing out the food, the inmates that is, I quit with the back of the food queue, which sounds counterintuitive, but if you think about it, when they're slopping out this stuff, you know what I mean? Like the first few servings are just going to be basically whatever's at the top, which is broth, not much at all. If you get to the back of the queue, you start getting the real stuff, the stuff that's going to help you survive. So the kitchen was a relatively covered position. We've already mentioned shoe testing track, obviously not somewhere you wanted to end up. Did anyone see the photograph of the soldiers, of the inmates removing the unexploded bombs in central Berlin? Did you see that one? Did you notice how one of them was dressed up in an Air Force uniform? It's clearly a propaganda photograph. That was an inmate wearing a military uniform. So obviously the reason they get inmates to do that job is because life expectancy is not high. There was the brick factory, which was to the southeast, about 3 kilometers in this direction. This brick factory was there ostensibly to help create bricks, which could be shipped down the canal, right back to Berlin, so that they could build up these monster buildings. Hitler didn't like Berlin the way it was. He envisioned a completely new, gigantic city. It might have ended up being called Germania, who knows, like the old Roman name for this part of Europe. That brick factory was one of the deadliest work details you could be assigned to. Sinti, Roma, homosexuals, Jews were sent there because life expectancy was not high, okay, the conditions were poor, and they ended up sending some of the biggest bastards they could to go and supervise that. So there was all different kinds of work you could be doing, a lot of it outside of the actual camp itself, but you're doing that for, on average around 12 hours a day, all right? Kitchen, that was one of the places you wanted to end up with. Okay. I don't want to sound like a broken record, but just to reiterate, the purpose of these camps before the Second World War, deadly as they were, okay, through disease and overworking and murder, out in that murder, the primary focus of these camps was labor, okay? We are standing in what was, again, a separate part to the main triangle, but still a part of the main camp, known as the industrial yard. Okay, so you had workshops, you had a shoe factory behind where the fence is today. This was a small vehicle parking area here, and the area we're overlooking now was a sand pit, okay, so for construction purposes. So again, nothing too sinister here, really, in the grander sense. But after the Second World War, the first of September 1939, we start seeing a shift in what's happening at the concentration camps. To reflect what's happening in Europe overall, okay, remember, the Nazis invade Poland on the 1st of September 1939, and apart from just, regular warfare, okay, we start to see the Nazi racial ideology influencing the behavior of the SS and the police that are, and to some extent the military, that are stationed in Poland, all right? For the Nazi ideology says that, the Poles or anyone of the Slavic racial group, okay, are considered subhuman, a superior race to the Aryan master race, which the Germans belong to. And so it is the Nazis' duty to enslave the population. So what they do is they go and set about rounding up people in leadership positions in Poland, and they start executing them. So people, teachers, people in the clergy, academics, people high up in the civil service, politicians. Estimates vary, but maybe somewhere in the vicinity of 60,000 people are murdered in the first 4 months in Poland. Okay, and the idea is with the rest of the population, okay, we are just going to be fit for manual labour, for agricultural work. We'll educate the children up to be able to count up to the number 500, and basically nothing more. So they're sort of colonising Eastern Europe. That's the idea here, all right? And so we start seeing the blood, the death toll starts to rise, and we start seeing that reflected in the camps as well, okay? So this sand pit is turned into an execution trench, all right? The majority of the people being murdered here are sort of resistance members, or people who are opposing the regime, whether they're German or from other countries. Okay, so the first person to be murdered here is a German who refuses to dig trenches for the Nazis. He says, screw your war, I don't want anything to do with it. So he's marched down here a week after the Polish invasion and executed by firing squad underneath where that roof is here. Okay, he has three SS non-commissioned officers following down, and each fire a shot in his direction. The idea there was, they sort of took what they learned from this medical type scenario and they changed to one of a shower. You know, that was the ruse. So a place like Treblinka, for example, which is outside of the city of Warsaw, okay, Treblinka was set up, had a phony train station there. Jews were being resettled in the east, is what they were told. They'd go to the phony train station, they would be told they would be having a shower and then a meal before continuing their journey. Of course, the meal never came. Instead of water in the shower area, there was gas. This was probably the most efficient method that the Nazis found in terms of eliminating their enemies. A place like Treblinka was set up only for 15 months, and in those roughly 15 months, at least 800,000 people were murdered there. Okay? You weren't spending 2 or 3 years of your life there, 2 or 3 months of your life, 2 or 3 weeks even. It was a few hours max. Okay, so again, those kinds of places influence places like Zaxxon. Okay, all right. So this is the infirmary dark. I've already mentioned to you some of the things that we've done here. Okay, so the drugs were being tested on the inmates here. They were checking up on that here. Homosexual men, okay, could often volunteer for castration. Okay, to try and remove the homosexual gene from the homosexuality from the gene pool. They were often told they could come here, have their testicles removed, and then be free to leave. Okay, but usually that was just the carrot that was being dangled. They would have the operation, then be sent straight back into their work depot. Other medical experiments took place here, mainly to try and strengthen the German war effort again. So they're testing chemicals, chemical warfare, mustard gas, phosphorus, things of that nature. All right. And also a particular strain of hepatitis has been tested on some young Jewish teenagers and boys here as well. All right. The Grey Buildings Pathology Center, this was used for autopsies. Okay, so technically every person that died in the infirmary for medical experiment or otherwise had to have an autopsy done, but mostly you're having orderlies do this. Inmates who don't have much medical experience. Only SS doctors would get involved if someone had undergone medical experiment and they could see what they could learn from this post-mortem. Okay. I've briefly mentioned this area before, okay, where the stones are. This was the camp brothel. I use the term brothel only because it's convenient, but this was another form of slavery, of course. This was for female inmates brought from the Ravensbrück female camp. They were here mainly for the inmates, okay? This was Himmler's idea. That if we give the inmates, because they're losing the war by 1944. Himmler says, well, if we give the inmates something to look forward to, they're going to work hard. And if you work hard enough, you could get a coupon which would give you 20 minutes with a woman. All right? Not that everyone who went into the brothel was there, did what was you were expected to do there. For some people, sex was something that was just so completely far from their minds once they entered into the concentration camp network. But we do know that some men did, because we know some women became infertile. One woman became pregnant and was shot on sight when it was found out that she was. Surprisingly,